This is the master bedroom of the basement development we're working on. I'm going to show you how to do the rough and electrical. In the basement, we've got planned for one light switch, two lights, and five plugs. The reason why I'm showing you the bedroom is that with a bedroom, you need an independent breaker, an arc fault breaker. So it's something that I can show you kind of all in one setup rather than going through the basement and showing you a bunch of confusing stuff. The bedroom is kind of gets done with one breaker, brought back to the panel, tied into an individual breaker. So let's get started. I'm going to, I've got my pen here, tape measure. I'm gonna do a layout for where I want my plugs to be. I'm gonna get the vapor barrier and insulation out of the way. Mount my boxes everywhere that they're gonna go and then drill my holes, pull my wire, and should be done what I need to do. This door here is gonna swing open this way. So I've got a perfect location here for some switches. I like the top of my boxes to be at 42 inches. So I'm going to measure off the floor. Give myself a little felt mark for the switch. Now, my local building code suggests that I can't have any receptacles or plugs, as you know it, further than 12 feet apart. In this layout, for convenience, and I suggest this for anyone viewing this, that it's better to put a couple more in than not have enough. The worst is putting a bedroom in with a nightstand and not having a plug there, running extension cords. So I'm gonna go a little closer than you normally would go. Basically, I'm gonna start with my first plug right here on this, and I like to put those at about 16 inches to the top. So I'm gonna mark it there. Now, here's what I'm talking about. 12 feet is further than this length of this wall, so I technically don't have to put a plug in until around here. But I think for convenience, I'm gonna add another one right on this stud here. Again, pull up my tape measure. Mark the 16 inches for the top. Okay. Now through here, because I've got the vapor barrier, we've obviously got to pull this vapor barrier out of the way, get the insulation out of here so that we can do our marking layout and drill our holes. So I need to grab a knife. Okay, so in our electrical layout, we're here at the exterior wall where we've got our insulation and vapor barrier. We need to remove the plastic out of the way as well as the insulation so that we can get the wiring in there. To do so, just grab your utility knife. I like to stay a couple inches off the ground. When I repair this back in, I'll use specified tape to retape the vapor barrier back together so it's accepted, acceptable by code standards, and go from there. This will be the final location of my last plug, so I don't need to cut any of this out. But now that I am flipping it up, I'm gonna cut on the stud. To about the height of where the bat line is. And I can flip this. Now that we've got our vapor barrier cut and able to pull up, I just grab my hammer tacker, stapler, and just gonna tack this poly out of our way. Okay, now that all the poly's up and out of our way, I'm gonna remove these bats of insulation. Okay, now that's complete, I'm going to get these out of the bedroom so that I've got space to drill my holes to run my wires. Now that we've got our insulation removed and our poly lifted up, I can finish the receptacle layout. Our last receptacle is right here, marked in the red. I'm going to add another one right here. Then one more right here. And finish off with one right here. So now that you've got your, I've got my five receptacles laid out, I'm going to proceed with mounting the receptacle boxes so that when I drill my holes, I'm not drilling any holes interfering with where the boxes need to be mounted. Okay, so this is the box I'm going to use for the light switch. It's identical to the boxes I'm going to use for the receptacles. I'm just going to show you a quick review on how to install it. So they've got some holes on the inside so that you can put some screws in on that angle. What I like to do is put the ones in at the top here, so, and one in the bottom. So stick your box on your line, hold it with your thumb, get your drill handy. All right, and that's a firmly mounted receptacle box. This is an exterior wall where we have the vapor barrier and insulation through it. When you're mounting a receptacle in that wall, it needs to be vapor barrier protected in a sleeve as well. So what I do is, this is a poly pan made exactly for this size box. Set it in its rough location. And put a couple staples in it, and then come into here. And this is where those inside mounting screws that you saw earlier come in handy, because I could just go inside the box, installing it that way rather than having to try to pull the plastic out of the way to get the screws in. And there you have it, poly pan in. When the vapor barrier comes back down, I'm able to seal around this, creating no air loss between the electrical box and the poly pan. Next, we're gonna go finish installing the rest of the boxes throughout the room and get ready to start drilling. Okay, so this is an octagon box. It's meant for lighting and has several other uses, but in our case, we're gonna use it to put up our rough in for electrical light. So here's our indicator point, creating from center to center and center to center. So using the same screws as before. Hold up the box on center. All right, nice and strong. Got one more light on this side, so exact same thing. Here's our indicator point. And there we go. So we're complete with boxing out our room. So we've got a switch, 5 plugs, and 2 lights. Next procedure is to bring out our drill, start drilling through the studs, so that we can pull our wires through. Okay, so now we're ready to drill out for the wiring to go through the studs. This is a screw tip auger bit. The screw tip goes into the wood and actually pulls the bit with it, so it enables quite a bit easier drilling. Can be picked up at any local hardware store. So here we go. Okay, so now here we have a situation where we couldn't keep drilling because it's going to come into the window. So we're going to drop the elevation of our holes and carry on through. I want to just show you the height of these boxes. Doesn't allow a lot of space up here to drill the holes either. So I'm likely going to pull the wires underneath these boxes through this section where the window is and then jump back up for the rest of it. Like I've hit a nail in there, so sometimes you got to make some adjustments. And okay, so we've got all our holes drilled now. We're using a 14-2 Lumex wire. I'm gonna start by fishing it through some of the holes in the TGIs or the floor joists at the panel location, bringing the wire to our first switch box and continuing on through to all the plugs. What I've got going on here is I hang my wire reel so I can get my wire quite easily, rather than leaving it on the ground and trying to uncoil it all apart. from our wire reel attached to the wall there, I started at our panel, up through a hole in the floor joist, started coming along. This joist here, I'm going to be stapling it along this beam, all the way to here. Then you can see the wires looped down, going towards our switch, which is right here. All our switch location, keep on following through. And bringing it all the way back to our last plug. Now what I'm gonna do is get my staples. These are electrical Lumex staples. Now this has got a S2 on it. That's meant for stapling two wires to the stud. This one's got a S1. So in this situation here, where it's just one wire, I'm just gonna use a S1. Tack it on like that. That'll be my service loop. And this is a long enough wire to do what I need to do. So from here, I'll carry on. So from that plug, I come back to this one. That's right here. Now this is where S2 staple comes in handy. So I leave enough wire. I'm gonna staple it to the side, and I'll leave enough wire. See how that wouldn't be enough, right? So I've gotta got my service loop and my extra wire. So that is enough wire. And there we go. So I'm gonna go through the rest of this room, doing the same thing with the stapling, all the way back to the panel to get all the wires neatly tucked into the spaces, and then we'll go through cutting these wires into the box. Okay, so what I'm gonna do now is, here's a 14-2 wire. I've got my home run feed from the panel going into the switch. Now I've got my out to the plugs heading that way. Now I'm gonna run this wire to the lights and to the second light and back to this switch. So I'll have three wires at this switch, one going to the panel, one going to the plugs, and one going to the lights. All right, here we are, light. So I'm just gonna get some S1 and S2 staples again so I can start stapling at our last location, which is this light, staple back to the second light, and then down to the switch, cut the line, and I should be ready to start tying in the boxes. Okay. Now, no stamping required through here. Just have to snug up the line. And back to here. Now, in this situation, because we got a skinny 2x4, I'm going to use, I've used S1 staples to staple down through here. I'm just going to use a S2 staple and go right over both of the wires, and that way I'm keeping it nice and tidy. Okay, another thing you'll notice here is I don't want to make my service loop here and come through here because I've only got two holes at the top to put these two wires through. So I'm actually going to run this wire down below and come up through the bottom. And there we go. So now we're here at the switch box. This has got three wires, as we spoke of earlier. One's the home run feed for the power from the panel. One's going to the plugs, and one's going to the lights. Gonna strip about 6 inches of wire. Now, I know that this is roughly 6 inches long, this body of the knife. So I just hold in like that. Snip it back and just go into the jacket a little bit. Like, you don't have to push hard to get through the jacket, and then you can pull it off just like that. Nice clean cut. Now, I really like to match all my wires so I can line it right up with the last one I did. And again, the ground wire is right in the center. So that's how you know you're not gonna slice these wires. You gotta pick the center of the wire. You push your knife through, and then you just got it straight down. Okay, and last. Okay, so there we go. Those are the wires that I'm gonna feed in through the box and have sticking out. I just want to explain the service loop now. When I put these wires down through these holes, there's a couple of clamps inside there. You want about 1/4 inch of the jacket to stick past this clamp when you tighten it down. Now, if during drywalling or any other procedure throughout the construction where one of these wires gets nicked or broken and there's not enough to hook up the device to it, they can loosen the clamp and feed more of this service loop through to be able to get another 6 inches of wire to be able to attach to. So, service loop, good idea. So there's always these tabs on the box. You just take off the ones you're going to use. In this case, I'm using the two at the top and one at the bottom. I'm going to start with putting this bottom one in since I'm down here. What I'm doing there is just tightening the clamp down onto the wire. Just snug, you don't need to pinch it in there too tight. Another thing I like to do is hook up my ground to the ground screw right away. And you can have a look in there. So you can see right there, I've got the 3/16 to a quarter inch of jacket sticking through. And I've got my copper bare line, the ground wire, on the ground screw. Now, whenever you're looping electrical wires onto screws or twisting on morettes, you always go in and put this around in the clockwise direction, which would be the way I'm tightening it down. If I put the wire around the other side and then I tighten it this way, it's gonna roll the wire off the screw, not enabling me to get this nice of a hold. So, okay, so that's the bottom one. Okay, get those sitting equal. Okay, so all these wires are attached, held into the clamp in the receptacle box. So I like to take the ones from the bottom, give them a nice bend in there, and stuff them in as far as you can so they're not going to get disrupted by the drywallers. They have a special tool to trim the drywall around the electrical box, but it involves navigating by sticking it in here first to find an edge and then jumping it around and then going around the perimeter of the box. When they stick that in, sometimes they grind these wires and will ruin them. And again, that's why the service loop and why you want to tuck them in. Okay, so we're at our first plug location. Again, when I was running the wires through, I've got these loops. To start, just cut off your loop end. It's best to not cut right in the center there, because then you're going to have some bent wires that you will never get straightened back out. So just come in a little bit. Again, I use my knife handle as a guideline. Right in there like that. Line it up again with the other one. Okay, so I've got my wire jackets off. Again, I'm gonna take out these tabs on top of the box. Okay, so basically this wire here is the one from the home run feed. This one is going to the next plug. I like to keep them in order, so I just kinda, I don't know, it's just good practice, you know what's going on. Fish them through. I'm gonna lean over and make sure I got just that quarter inch of jacket sticking through. Clamp down, make sure you're good and tight. separate your jacketed wires up so you can get your grounds on. And tighten your ground down. Okay, take your wires. There we go, all tucked in for safety. Clean up your loop a little bit. And that's a plug roughed in.
Okay, now we're gonna go through running low voltage wires, coax for cable, Cat5 for telephone, speaker wires, all sorts of various low voltage wires. When you're running a low voltage wire, you don't wanna share holes with regular electrical. If you take your coax line and your Cat5 line, and I went through these same holes, the power current that runs through the wire will interrupt with the current that's supposed to go through these wires. So you generally keep them running in their own holes. I'm going to be pulling both these wires at the same time from this box all the way to the panel. I'm going to begin by taping the wires together. That way they run smoothly together. And I'm going to start at our box location, up through the hole, and back to the panel. So now we're back at the panel with our coax and Cat5 line. I like to make sure I have ample amount of wire. It's gonna be connected into these cable lines here.
and the blue line will be connected into the telephone system there. So sufficient amount of line, coil it up. Very cautious not to kink this wire. It will cause damage that you can't get at later. Bedroom cable telephone, rec room cable telephone. I'm ready to go back and staple this back to the bedroom, and that'll be done. Okay, now we've got our wire stapled all the way back to the box. I'm gonna want to leave extra wire before I cut it off. All right, so now with these light gauge wires, you can't bend them in the similar way that this is going on, or you'll cause damage to the wires. So what I like to do is feed them through their own holes on this box. Bring out the end. Tape it together. Now, taping those together will prevent these wires from being able to slip back out of the box. So what I do is one bend to get it in there, and then you've got a position these wires into the wall so they can be loosely pulled down once the drywall is done to do the final connections. So I've got my wires up into the wall. I just want to temporarily fasten it with some tape so the wires don't interfere with the application of the drywall. Then when this cable telephone is getting hooked up, the person can pull on the wire and the tape will release, and they will have all this extra slack to work on putting the cable ends and telephone ends on. Okay, now that I've got my wire taped in here roughly into the position, I'm just going to show what will happen inside the wall once the workman puts the ends on this TV telephone line. So they would just grab onto this and pull.
and they can gain all the wire that they need. These wires will be safely in between the two layers of drywall. I'm in the finished part of the home, right above the rec room that's in the basement where I'm going to be installing some recessed lighting. I'm going to be following the same grid pattern as we've got here, three rows of three. I'm going to take you downstairs and show you the rough-in procedures for this, and if you want to go with some recessed lighting, then you'll know how. Okay, so now we're down in the basement where I was just discussing the recessed lighting. This is the style of recessed lighting that I'm using. It's more of a after fit. So we are in fact gonna drywall the whole ceiling and then drill our holes to fit these up into the ceiling space, hook the wires up to it and attach the trim, and that will be our finished light. In this area, I've got loops of wires that are hanging from the ceiling in the approximate location. So there's nine, there's 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. These three are hooked up to temporary lights that I will use during the mudding and taping process and to finish the construction project. And here are the other three. These wires are coming out of the switch that is over here. So with the recessed lighting that we're putting into the rec room area, I'm going to install it on a three-way switch so that it can be activated from this location or at the back door location. To start this rough-in for the recessed lighting, I need to bring a power feed from the electrical panel to this switch. I run a three-wire from this switch to the other switch, and from the other switch I run a two-wire to the nine pot lights, and that will connect a three-way circuit for the recessed lighting. Okay, so I'm at the back location where the three-way switch is going to be installed. You can see this red wire here is the extra three wire that was ran from switch to switch, and the black and white wire up to the first pot light in our series. Okay, so now that my ceiling is taped, ready to be sanded, I've got one last thing I want to do before I sand, and that's drill out the holes and pull the wires down for the pot lights, just so that I know that I've got them all located and I'm not going to have to do any mudding and taping touch-ups, etc. So this is the time. How I'm going to proceed with doing that is measure all the way around the four perimeter walls on the grid pattern that I originally roughed those wires in up there. I'm going to apply some thumbtacks near those lines and use some fishing line to connect all the indicator points to create a 12 line grid, which will give me my nine pot light locations. It would be a lot easier just to chalk some lines up on the ceiling to find the indicator points where I'm gonna drill the holes, but chalk lines will always be showing through the paint or texture or whatever you're doing on your ceiling after. So you've got to use a dry line and then use a pencil to mark the X location and then drill out your holes. Okay, so now that I've got my 12 locations located on the four walls, I'm going to use a thumbtack, push it into the ceiling at those locations, And then connect all the tacks together with some fishing line, which will give me my grid pattern. So now that I've got the string line attached to the 12 tacks, you can see that where they're intercrossing each other is the pot light location. So this tack, these three tacks are exactly parallel with those three tacks, and these three are parallel with those three. So connecting them all up, here's one, two, three, four, five, six, seven, eight, and finally, nine. So now I'm gonna use my pencil at this inner indicating point just to mark it so I can take my tacks down and I know where to drill my holes. Okay, so now that you've got your nine indicator points marked out for where the pot light wire should be, it's time to grab your cordless drill with your appropriate size hole saw that matches with your pot lights. Drill into each of these locations and pull the wires down. So this is the hole saw that is suited for the pot lights that I've chosen for down here. It's a 3.5-inch hole saw. If I was to just start drilling right away, I might not hit the indicator point perfectly. So I've just got a regular nail and I'm going to make a little center hole so that this bit has a good hole, good starting point to follow down. Thank you.
There we go.
There's my wire for my pot lights.
Okay, so that's our 9 pot light locations in the rec room. You can see that I did refine the wires up in the ceiling space. I'll tuck these away just so that I can finish sanding the ceiling. Once the ceiling's primed, I'll go through and hook up all these lights. Okay, so now that I've got my holes cut for my pot lights and I've got my wires pulled down, stripped, and got about an inch of the jacket removed, I'm going to go through and install one of these pot lights now. So here is the pot light or recess light. It's got a finished trim on it, so I'm going to remove that. This is where your light would plug into once you've got it installed. These clips that are inside here are what helps it hold into the drywall when you put it up there. So you get your wires in through the back and then you stuff it up. And then once it's in perfectly, you push those clips down and it'll hold the light in position. So now you can, on this light, you got access panel either on left side or the other side, the right side. I'm just gonna use this side. Pull out your wires. I've got a ground wire and my hot and neutral line. So I'm just gonna match up my white to my white and my black to my black. Twist on the morettes, and then close the cover back off. So with this light, to get the actual Lumex wire into the box, I've got 2 covers back here to break one of them out to use. So I'm gonna use the bottom one. So you just bend it down back and forth a bit. Till it's removed. Then I got a
connector. So you wouldn't want to ever leave a bare Lumex wire just through a hole like that. Eventually the copper and the metal will corrode against each other and it'll start shorting out. So you've got to put a connector on in this hole to run the Lumex wire through here and clamp down on it. Again, just like a receptacle box where I was leaving that quarter inch of jacket through, we'll do a similar situation with this. So to get these in, you just compress them a little bit and they've got a little groove here that they'll lock into once they get in. Okay, so you can see I've got my connector in there. I'm loosening it off because I'm going to stuff two wires in there, which are right here. So like at the start when I was stripping these wires, I had mentioned to you that keeping them even is a nice helpful way to go about it. So I could try to stuff these two through the hole like this, but I also like to just give it a wrap of tape first to hold the wires together in their position before I stuff them in. So, got my electrical tape right here. Line up these two wires perfectly. Just a couple wraps to hold it. Okay, now I'm ready to bring up my fixture. Now when you're pulling stuff through, you just want to be gentle that you don't nick your wires on the sides of the steel or anything like that. So I just gotta loosen it off a bit more so I can fit the two wires through. Okay, there we go. So you see in the box there that my jacket is now sticking through. That's what you wanna see just to know your wire's not gonna get any damage and that it is in there far enough. So now I'm just tightening that screw which pushes the clamp tightly onto the two wires and they should be stuck in that position. All right, so you can see here I can pull my wires to where I need them to work and the pot light or the recessed light can hang from the wires nice and secure so that you can work on the rest of hooking it up. So whenever I'm twisting wires, again, I'm always going in that clockwise motion because that's how the Moret is designed to go on. You're always twisting wires in a clockwise motion so that when you put your Morets on, they're also going in the same motion. So I usually just start by twisting my two Lumex ground wires together and then I'll wrap this one nice around it. So you can see that that's not really ever going to come apart. Then I'll take a Moret. This Moret itself is sized for 2 to 3 wires. So you can see that I'm perfect with this situation. Stuff your Moret on, put ample pressure downward and begin to twist it until you can see it climbing down the wire. Now, you definitely gotta keep good pressure on it as you're turning it. Now that's max turning, like I wouldn't wanna strip it or anything, but you can always test it after by pulling at it to see if it's held down. Now, an extra step that I like to do, it's maybe a little over excessive on the ground wire, but just to make sure that these hold when I go stuffing them back into the box, I just throw a little bit of tape. Oh geez. Throw a little bit of tape on there and then I know that when I'm stuffing them in the box that it's going to stay where it needs to. All right. So I'll just begin with my neutral. Trim those a little shorter. Okay, you can see I've got all three wires nice and twisted together. Got another Moret.
Just hold on one second. I'm just trying to get a better shot of this here. Okay, you can go ahead and Moret it.
Okay, so I got my Moret. Lots of pressure downward. Clockwise motion. Can feel it climbing down that wire. All right, nice and tight, give it a little test. Okay, nice and secure. Moving on to the black wires. Got those twisted nice. Give it a pull. Okay, so all my three wires are all twisted together and moretted off. Now I've got to manipulate these wires to get them tight in the box so I can put the cover back on. This is where taping them really helps because then you know your moret is stayed in position. And there you have it. And here's my final cover again. In the slot, click down. So this is finished wired up, ready to go. So now I'm going to push it up into the hole, make sure the wires are feeding down through the floor joist, and then pop these things into position. When I stuff the recess light up into the hole, the way that it holds firmly in the drywall and why it was so precise to make these holes the exact size is that inside, once I've got it up, I've got these two tabs on the inside. When I get it up in the hole, I push these tabs down and it brings this tab all the way over and presses against the top of, or the other side of the drywall, keeping the pot light or recess light in position. So start with those in the down position. Bring your light, or grab your wires, see which way they're gonna go. I can feed mine back down that way. When you're putting these up, make sure you're getting no resistance with tucking your wires up there. If you're getting resistance, try another route with your wire. It's just better to do that rather than have something come loose or be tugging on the electrical wire. So mine went up nice and smooth. Just gonna pop it the rest of the way. So you can see there that I'm in perfect. So now all that's left to do is to push these tabs, and this last push with your finger as hard as you can locks it in tight. All right, so both of those are locked down, and that's installation of recessed lighting. I'm in the washroom now. I'm going to hook up the light switch, switch to the fan, and the GFI outlet. So to begin with that, I'm gonna pull out all my wires for my rough in. I've got these moretted off because of temporary power that I had to provide for lighting when construction was going on down here. So I'm just gonna pull all of it out, show you what I'm gonna do. So I like to start by just separating everything off just so that you can see what's going on. Okay, so this is my GFI. From rough-in time, I hooked this ground wire up to the lug screw that's in the back. That's good practice. If you didn't do it at rough-in time, make sure you've got that lugged in underneath the screw, then you can trim that one right off because you're grounded. Just give yourself some extra space in the box. Now, this ground wire is actually gonna get hooked up to my receptacle under the ground screw. Most receptacles that I've ever seen, the ground has a green screw on it so that you can identify it. The copper color screw is usually, in all cases, is the black, the power, and the silver screw is how to indicate to the white wire. So in my situation, I'm going to lug the two whites in on this side that are here, and the two blacks in on this side, and the copper onto the green ground screw. Okay, start with my two whites. Okay, those are nice and tight. This one's a little long. Getting them in there parallel is a bugger sometimes. There we go. Oh, Jesus. All
Okay, so my two blacks are hooked up. Now the ground. Okay, so all my wires are hooked up to this GFI receptacle. Now the problem is these receptacles are quite thick. So you really have to bend your wires properly to get this box inserted into the wall. So what I like to do is start down here and kind of bend it in to go back there. Bring the wires up and kind of bend them into the back corner the other way. And press it in. So you can see here that I've got my GFI squished in, and because I put the kink in the wire at the bottom, that should fold down, and then when I got up to the corner, it should fold back down the other way. So one thing that you never really want to do is rely on the screwing of these screws to pinch your wires back, because if the wires are in fact getting pinched between something, there's no way to tell. You want to use your hands to make sure that you've got it free to be able to go all the way back into the box. So now that I know that it's like that, align that top screw up with the hole, begin to tighten it down about halfway. Get the bottom one lined up. Again, about halfway. And common mistake here is to just rely on the screw to push the box in. You want to use your hand so that you're not pinching wires, just so that you make sure that it can go freely on its own. So I can push this in with my hand and then finish tightening down the screw. Okay, so that one is finger tight. The top is not, but you can see that I can get that in freely. So now, now I'm gonna push this in and finish the top one. Okay, that's looking pretty good. Now there, on these two screws that attach to the block, there is a wider hole cut into it so that you can level your receptacle before you tighten it down. You see how I've got this movement in it still. So I've got a fairly keen level eye, so I'm not gonna pull out a level, but if you need to, you can put a torpedo level on the side of it before you tighten it down. That's looking really good to me. Okay, so that's all hooked up, ready to go. Once I'm done my finished paint in here, I will put the plate cover over the top of it. Moving along to my switch location. A switch breaks the power from the device that it's going to the black, to the power. So this one here is my power to the fan. One of these here is my power from the panel, and the other one is the power up to the light. So what I need to do is I need to take this power and split it off to be able to bring one to the switch for the fan and one to the switch to the light. So in a switch location like this, you would typically take your three whites, connect them all, one to the fan, one from the panel for the power or from the last device, and one up to the light. So those all get connected together so that there's no just connecting the circuit all together. Okay, so here's all my grounds too. Just gotta untwist them from temporary power that we had going here. Just separate them off. And one of these is extra, so it can get trimmed off back at the box. Okay, so now that I've got my neutrals or my whites all connected together, I need to determine I know this one's the black one goes up to the fan, but I need to determine which one of these two actually carries the power from the panel. So I have the panel breaker turned on. I've got my tester here, so I'm just gonna check. Nothing there. Right there. So that's the power from the panel. This is up to the light, and this is up to the fan. So I'm gonna shut my breaker off now, show you guys how to finish connecting this up. Okay, so this I've determined is the power. I need to connect this power to both of these areas as well with the break of the switch between it. So this block would go on one terminal on the switch, and power from this wire here would go on the bottom terminal. And when you turn the switch on, it connects these two inside. When you turn it off, it breaks the line between. So you can see that I've only got one wire though. So what I have to do is create something called a pigtail. Now, to do that, I take the same wire, this is a 14-2 that I used originally in the rough-in. I need the black wire out of this. So, pull it out. I've already got the other one. So what you're gonna do is, these are a little bit long. I like to use about something like that. Strip both ends. Oops. Just like that. Now this is my hot. So I'm gonna murette these three wires together. So I group them all up evenly. Just like that, got my pliers. Clockwise twisting. And you wanna get them as tight as you can, going together. And then you can see here that always kind of get a little weird at the end, so I just kind of trim it up a little bit so that the murette fits on well. So now that you've got your three wires together off the hot, twist the murette on, and those go on perfectly clockwise. That's why everything in this situation is clockwise. Okay, so there you go. So now I turn the one hot into two. So you can see here that I need on the switch for my light, I've got my hot, and then I got my power going up to the light. So when these make a connection internally in the switch, the light is going to power up. Now on this side, I've got my hot from the splice that I've made going to the hot on the fan, and that's going to turn the fan on. So the white ones are no longer necessary. So I'm going to get them tucked away. As far back as I can. I'm gonna grab my switch now. These hook up a little differently than the GFI. You remember the GFI was sliding them in and then tightening the screw down. These work in a manner that you create a loop like that and you go around a lug screw and then tighten it down. Because I'm going to be
tightening this screw clockwise, I want to make sure that I loop this on clockwise. That's very, very important. If I loop this on backwards and I'm turning it clockwise, it's going to actually spin out and flop off. So I'm turning this screw clockwise. This wire needs to go around that screw clockwise. Okay, so that's all tightened up. Now I'm gonna go to my power. On these switches, they've got a spot for me that I can just do a quick connect where I could just take these and jack them in. I still prefer to do the looping method and going around the screws. But it looks like on these ones that it's actually giving you the option to do the same as the GFI and tuck a straight line or straight wire in and lug it down. So I'm going to bypass the quick connect method and just go with the screw and the lug down method. Now, in this situation, it doesn't matter if I put the one to the light on the top or the bottom. The switch is going to work the same either way. So I've got the one going up to the light here, and here's my other one that is the power. Long. Okay, so that one's hooked up. On this light switch, it in fact gives me an indicator that tells me that that's the top. So I know that once I get my other one hooked up, I can get these wires grouped together nice and push them back in. Okay, so now I've got this switch hooked up. I'm going to get the other one finished off. Okay, so both these switches are hooked up now. I'm just going to play around with the wires and try to get them in the best, get these wires bent in and stuffed in the best possible way that I can. Okay, that's looking pretty good. Just gonna start these screws. Okay, with the screw started, I'm gonna push the receptacle back. Okay, that one's gonna go freely. So is that one, so I can begin to tighten them the rest of the way down.
Okay, so I've got both my switches installed and my GFI installed. I'm gonna go flip my breaker on and check the fan and the light switch. Okay, power's on. Light switch works good. Fan works good. Now, you got one more chance at leveling these switches when you go to do your finish and put your plate covers on. But for now, this is done until final paint's complete.
Go ahead.
Okay, so I'm in the washer now. I've got the actual light fixture that I've chosen for here. This is a temporary light that I've got set up during construction and during filming. So I'm going to shut my breaker off, remove this light, and install this light.
Okay.
Okay, so now that I've got my breaker shut off that supplies the power to the light, I'm going to remove the bulb and remove the temporary light fixture and begin to install the new fixture. Okay, so my temporary light fixture was one where you looped the wires into a half loop and lugged them underneath some screws. My new fixture is going to involve me moretting these wires to existing wires that are in this fixture. So I need to get some pliers and straighten these wires out. Okay, so those are straight. Don't know if you can see in the box, but I've got my ground wire already lugged on the screw that's in the box. I'm gonna need these two screws to mount the mounting bracket that comes with my light. Here's my light. This is the mounting bracket that they supply. It's got these two finger nuts that are on the front. I'm just gonna remove those. Okay, that should free up this back plate. Okay, so I'm going to install this plate up into this box and then adjust this to make these two lugs perfectly level, which is what the light fixture has them mounted as. So I'm gonna slide this up, pull my ground out. Okay, so that's mounted in there. To position this plate so that these two bolts are sitting level. Right here is my ground screw. So I can right away loosen that up a bit. Here's the back of my light switch. There's my ground cable. Now that the light fixture is mounted to the
to the box, and now that this clip is mounted to here, I'm going to lug the light fixture onto this grounding screw, and that will ground the light fixture to the box. So, again, if you noticed, I wrapped that wire around clockwise. Okay, so that is good and tight. Bring my wires down to where I can hold them. Give the light fixture wire kind of wrapping around the copper line clockwise. Twist your Moret on.
Here, just can you take the Moret off so I can get a close up quick?
Yeah.
Okay, good.
Got my Moret. Gonna twist that on in a clockwise position. Give it a tug, seems good. Okay, those are moretted in. Again, pulling to check. Now, got this wire right here. I am gonna twist my two ground wires together. It's just a extra that the grounds are connected. And since I'm there, why not throw a Moret? I'm not gonna be able to throw a Moret on it, but I've twisted them together, tuck them out of the way. I'm just gonna use some tape and tape these up. Okay, those are all taped up. I'm gonna begin to lift the light fixture up into position. And these wires are gonna sit in here, which will be hidden by the plate of the light fixture. Okay, so you can see that I'm mounted in there and this threaded rod is sticking out at the top and bottom. My thumb nuts only have a 3/16 of threading, so if I thread this on, that's my maximum thread. So when I keep cranking it in, it will actually tighten inside the light, but not tight enough this time. So you can see that I've got to bring that threaded rod down another 1/4 inch so that this lug will work. Okay, so they do that because if my box wasn't in the correct position, which it is,
that I could still have long enough studs to make this fixture work. So I'm gonna screw back this nut and lock washer to the distance that I wanna bring it down. And I'll screw in the, threaded rod down to that height again, which will reduce the length of the rod. Okay, got those adjusted. Gonna try this again. Okay, you can see that I've reduced them down, that they're just barely poking through. Got that one on, finger tight. Got that one on. Make some adjustments to this light. Okay, so I've got the light up there. Looks safely mounted, secure. I'm gonna turn my breaker back on and give it a test. Okay, power's back on. Oh, and there we go. Finished light fixture in position. I don't much care for these labels that are on here. You definitely need to leave them on or relabel it somehow that someone would be able to buy the right bulbs for the fixture. Not many people know, but you are running a risk of fire by putting the incorrect bulbs into fixtures. Sometimes they get too hot and they will burn up the insulation that's on the fixture or whatnot. So you really have to follow the recommended spec'd light bulbs for each fixture that you put up. Okay, so I'm at receptacle location. Got my receptacle here. This is a tamper-proof receptacle. I don't know if you can see inside the slots there, but it's got a piece of plastic that blocks kid from being able to stick a paper clip or something inside there and get electrocuted. So my local building code requires me to install tamper-proof receptacles. So make sure you check what your guidelines are in your area. But as far as the receptacle itself, they all hook up the same whether they're tamper-proof or not. So again, this one has the holes for the quick connects, 1, 2, 3, 4 holes. If you are gonna use the quick connects, you strip your wires about 1 inch long and you just jack them into the back and then they're not supposed to be able to pull back out. I like to do the method where I'm going on these lug screws, because even if I use the quick connects, I still have to screw these lug screws down into the all the way down position so that they're not bulking out. Because if someone was to touch this before the play was on, they would get electrocuted. So it's just common practice to drive these screws all the way down if you're gonna use the quick connects. So again, I've got my I've got my wire going into my plug and I've got my wire going out of my plug to the next plug. So at the rough in stage, I grounded this wire to the box. So I'm going to trim it off. Just get it out of the way.
strip off my jackets. In the method that I use, when I go around the screw, I'm just looking for about a 1-inch chunk of wire exposed, maybe a little less, 3/4 to 1 inch. Use my strippers to clamp near the end to create that bend. So it's clamp on, roll it around. Okay, so I've got those bent, then the ground. Okay, so I've got those all bent how I like them. I'm gonna start with the ground screw, which is the green one. Loop it on clockwise. And tighten down. Silver screws, I know those are for my white. Clamp those both on in the clockwise position. Plug over, attach the black to the copper screws. Okay, so that's all hooked up. Nice and all my screws are nice and tight down on the wires. If I was setting this receptacle up for temporary power during construction, I would likely wrap a tape around this plug to block off these screws from another tradesman either getting a trowel in there and getting electrocuted or whatever might be the case. Because I'm working here by myself and I know myself that I will be cautious around those areas, I'm not gonna tape those off. But like I said, if you're setting up some temporary plugs for other tradespeople on your job site, you might want to tape those off just so that everybody's safe from getting electrocuted. Now I'm just gonna figure out the bend to get my wire squeezed in there. I like to always kind of come to the bottom corner, kink it up, make another kink in the wire and push it back. So you can see that I've got them lined up with the screws. Just get the screws started. And proceed with making sure that you can get it compressed back like that without using the screws to do that for you. Again, you don't want to pinch the wires in there by tightening with the screws. You want to push it in with your finger and know that you're not clamping down on the wire that's in there. Just adjust your receptacle for level. Mine's looking pretty good there. Just finished tightening down on it. So this is good. Now once the two coats of finished wall color go on, I will come in after and put the finished plate over top of the receptacle. Okay, one thing I like to do to dress up a staircase and for safety reasons is put in these stair lights. These are just a standard receptacle box
with the LED light insert and a cover plate to finish. Gonna show you downstairs how these were roughed in, and if you wanna, we should see that again.
Okay, that's fine.
Where should I start from?
Just the beginning.
Okay. Okay. You all ready?
Yep.
Okay. So these are some stair lights that I've installed in the upstairs of the home. I'm going to do the same down in the basement. These lights install into a regular receptacle box with an LED strip and then a finished decor cover to finish off the box. I'm gonna show you downstairs how these were cut in and wired up.